Torn, please. This is the City of Victoria Planning Commission regular meeting for Thursday, October the 23rd, 2014. If anyone has any cell phones, please put them on silent so we don't disturb this meeting.
Oops.
All right, well, go ahead and let's look over the minutes and get approval for September 18 minutes. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
I have a motion by Mr. Woods.
Second.
I have a second by Mr. Spears. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Minutes pass. Okay. Now we'll open up for citizen communications. Anyone wishing to recognize this commission on any issues not specifically on this agenda, please do so at this time. Okay, it looks like we don't have anybody. We'll go ahead and close that, and I'm going to turn it over to Jaron for development and review formal actions.
Evening, commissioners. Our first agenda item is the Victoria Putt-Putt subdivision. This is a final plat with one variance request. It's 1.13 acres located at 3102 Sam Houston Drive near the intersection of Sam Houston and Laurent. The applicant's proposing to plat the property into one general commercial lot. It currently contains an existing putt-putt golf course. Here you can see the plat for the subdivision. A few aerial images of the subdivision. Water service is currently provided by an existing 8-inch main along Sam Houston. Sewer service is provided by an existing 10-inch main along Sam Houston. Drainage will be in accordance with the master drainage plan of the city. It does have frontage on Sam Houston, which is an existing secondary arterial. You can see here a picture of the front of the lot. This lot has a variance request in which they are asking to waive a 5-foot right-of-way dedication. There is a sign that would be impacted with this dedication. The property fronts is very close to the sidewalks there. So they're asking for the variance of the City Code Section 2154B2, requires the dedication of one half of the right-of-way necessary to bring a street into conformance. Approval of this variance would allow them to waive that right-of-way dedication, which is 5 feet. They're proposing one lot. Staff did offer an option to create a license agreement in which the right-of-way would be dedicated and the property would be allowed to maintain its current layout until the property changes uses. And the applicant has decided to deny that option. A few in favor of the variance request. It won't create a negative effect on the surrounding property, and it will allow the development to continue its operation with its current layout. Against it, granting it would create a non-conforming lot and the license agreement option that I just discussed earlier. But staff does recommend approval of this variance request. I can answer any questions if you have them.
I wasn't here when the initial plat came through. How much, if you could go back to the picture of what the proposed plat would be, they're combining two commercial lots into one? Is that the plan?
Don't believe so, no.
This is an unplatted lot.
Okay.
And they're platting it because they have plans to build a new structure at the back of the property. The building permit for that is what will trigger the platting. So it's an unplatted lot. It's been there for decades.
Long time.
Long time.
Thank you.
I would believe Victoria would probably be the only city that has a putt-putt subdivision. I didn't realize we had a putt-putt subdivision.
Does that make it historical?
It may be a historical landmark. I don't know. It's been there longer than I have.
It is.
Jaron, I just have a question, and it's just general. On a license agreement, is that generally something any developer takes advantage of? Very rarely, huh?
No, and it's something that staff is starting to use a little more often.
Okay.
It was an option that we offered that would have allowed the city to take the right-of-way, offer a license agreement that would allow them to maintain those improvements that are there in their current configuration. But, you know, if for some reason someday it's no longer putt-putt and someone pulled all of that, you know, and redeveloped the track, then at that time the license agreement would expire and the city would already have the right-of-way, would have gotten the right-of-way. But
what's the advantage of even, what's the advantage of a license
agreement? Well, there are advantages to the city and the city go.
Well, certainly to the city, to the developer, not. He'd save on the variance fee, but that's...
Well, right, it would have eliminated the need for variance, and to have come before this body would have been able to approve it as a minor plat.
So and he gets to keep the property the way it is as long as he doesn't change the putt-putt course.
Well, I understand, right. But at some point he would have to give up that.
Well, that was going to be a question. Is it at some point if ownership changes, or is it just if the putt-putt is torn down and something else built in its place?
You're talking about for the license agreement or for the variance?
License agreement.
Okay. Yeah, for the license agreement, it would have... One, it was never drafted, so normally it would be about the redevelopment of the site, not necessarily change in ownership. So they could have conveyed it, but you know, they chose to... There's a sign in the right-of-way here, or in the area that would be dedicated if they did do that, in addition to the two holes, or three, two, part of at least two holes, or... would be impacted, so they just chose to go with the variance and see if they were able to retain the property. And we've, over the last 2 or 3 years, have approved a couple of variances on the other end of Sam Houston, for properties that were a little more shallow than this. But
my question is this: this was triggered by a requested permit for development at the back of the property. What are we looking at that's going to be impacting this entrance or this right of way?
My understanding, it's a storage facility for Dr. McNeil owns this. It's the Twin mm-hmm. Vines Fountain Clinic is next door, and it's a storage facility for that mobile clinic vehicle or vehicles. So it'll be vehicles. It's basically vehicle storage, a big garage that's going to be built at the back. It's not associated with the putt-putt business.
He just wanted to build a metal building back there for personal storage and what have you for the clinics and their mobile units.
Right, right.
So there's not going to be a new commercial type
sir.
Location that's going to be accessing all this stuff.
No, sir.
Okay. But there could down the road.
Sure. They could choose at any moment to cease the putt-putt and redevelop the site into something else that would fit. Of course, they'd have to go through the site plan and building permit process and... you know, meet all of the current standards after that with that new development.
Any more questions? Anybody?
Can you go back to the
sorry?
Sky view of the whole lot is, I think it's, there you go.
I believe the intent is for the warehouse to be in the back left of the property.
Okay. And is the driveway sufficient in size for a commercial building in the back of the property?
Honestly, I don't know if we've looked at that yet. We've just been trying to get...
Okay, so we're just...
Okay, yep. It probably will work.
Put the cart before the horse.
They'll need to do a site plan. And have we already gotten? We've already gotten that, haven't we?
John looked at it. It meets it.
Okay.
I don't know what it is, though.
Sounds like we've already looked at it, and it does meet it.
All right. Is that all?
Yes, sir.
All right. Well, let's go ahead and open it up for a public hearing on this. Does anybody wish to address this panel on this? Go ahead and come to the podium and state your name and address, please, sir.
My name is Dr. John McNeil, 101 Pasadena Drive in Victoria, Texas.
All right, sir.
I can answer any of these questions about this. I mean, the thing that we're building back there is, you know, we've got that parking lot behind Putt-Putt, and this all started because we bought that mobile unit, and I just want to keep it out of the Texas sun, so we're building a metal building back there that's just nothing more than a garage. So. We had the land back there behind it, and you can see that the parking lot stops, and we have to be 10 foot off of the back and 5 foot or 10 foot off the side, whatever it is. The site plan, I think, is already done. this all came up because we had to have it platted because it had never been platted before. Well, then they came up and said, well, guess what? Your sidewalk sits right on the sign, which is right on Sam Houston. And I said, well, what do we do? And they said, well, you got to go talk to those people down there and get a variance. And I said, I got another one. I got another variance today, so I'm not through. But anyway, I've never had one in my life. I have two today. But anyway, the thing is that if we didn't have the variance, if we ever lost that, I would lose two of the 18-hole golf course. It would be a 16-hole golf course. Two or three. There's one of them that's kind of questionable. So the way putt-putts are laid out, I mean, honestly, the putt-putt layout here is the same as the putt-putt. I think they actually have one in Tokyo. So they're identical everywhere. So the putt-putt doesn't let you change the golf course. And you'll never see a putt-putt with a windmill or a big clown face or anything like that. I mean, they're just putt-putts. That's all they are. And so this is actually one of the oldest ones. And actually, somebody had said something about a historical marker. And we're actually looking into that because... Right. I mean, there's probably a bunch of people in this room that played putt-putt when they were kids. So that's how, myself included. And that's how it all came up, because we were just, all we needed was a plat, or we had to have it platted because we're putting that 50 by 40 metal building back there in the back. And that's just going to basically be a big garage for that 43-foot truck that we bought for a mobile clinic.
Okay. How old is the putt-putt?
You know, when I bought it, it was 38 years old. Then, so, and that was about 5 years ago. So I think it's 43 or 45 years old. So
50 years. If it's over 50 years, it would qualify for a...
Well, we're getting close. We're getting close. You know, Mr. McCaskill had that forever, and yeah. I actually bought it from him. And I can promise you, somebody said something about replatting it and redoing it. Trust me, when I said that I was buying the area back there for a parking lot, that got changed into I'm knocking the putt-putt down for a parking lot. And I got letters from people saying, you better not knock that putt-putt down. I told everybody that the soccer moms united against me. So that will stay a putt-putt as long as I own it. And I have no intention of selling it. So, anyway.
If, Dr. Mignell, if your intention is to keep the putt-putt kind of historic in the way it is, and I understand about the putt-putt because... would not the agreement with the city that as long as you leave it the way it is, the variance or not the variance isn't needed, and the city's not going to encroach with their 5 feet.
Yeah, you know, I didn't even
unless
know
what down the road you decide to redesign and change and move everything.
No, I can guarantee I wouldn't do that.
Well, I know, but I'm just saying that what the city's offering is an opportunity that if you don't change it, everything's cool. But if you do decide to tear it down and build a new one, improve it or whatever, then the 5 foot would come
then
into play.
Then that would definitely come into play. And actually, I asked that same question to the civil engineer that did that, and he said, you don't want to do that, just ask for the variance. That's what he told me. So anyway, I didn't even know that other thing existed until he told me that. And so, any questions I can answer about that? All right.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Dr. McNeil. Thank you all for your time.
Anyone else wishing to address the panel? If not, I'll go ahead and close it, and we'll do final plat and then our deliberations.
I think I'm okay with it.
I'm good.
I'd really like, I know, I had a long discussion about this with somebody at lunch today. She's 14, and we were talking about the putt-putt because she's played there since she was little and all that. And I'm torn between the need of the city to try to ensure and protect the right-of-way that we've got on Sam Houston and to try to ultimately, whether it be 10 years from now, 20 years from now, or even 50 years from now, get Sam Houston the width that it's supposed to be, with the sidewalks the way it's supposed to be, with everything what is planned for long term, and the importance of having that putt-putt there and the historical significance and the feel-good significance of the putt-putt. I really wish that Dr. McNeil would have gotten a little bit better or different advice or maybe more advice regarding what the city was offering, because my suggestion would have been let's, as long as he leaves it the way it is, everything's fine, but at some point down the road, if that property changes hands, or if he decides to redesign it, which I believe he's not going to, I think he's planning on leaving it there long after you and I are sitting here talking about it. But 40 years from now, if that property is going to be owned by somebody else, and if they decide to do, this variance sticks. And if the rest of Sam Houston is, by that point, the way that the city planned it and the way we'd like to have it, and we got this one little chunk right there that, that falls out of it, I just think that I would like to see maybe the city revisit with Dr. McNeil about what it really means and what they were really proposing, rather than granting a variance.
You know, we've approved two of these already.
I wasn't aware of that until it was mentioned a few minutes ago, and I didn't.
Further, closer to the corral side, but I know we've done two of these.
About that laundromat?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to interject one thought. You know, if it's 40 years from now and the street needs to be widened, we still have the option of condemning that property. So we can gain city can gain possession of it.
Yeah, but I hate when the city does it that way. You know, I'd rather work with the property owner than be in an adversarial relationship with the property owner.
Well, I think Dr. McNeil has gotten good advice, whether we think it's good advice or bad advice, and he's come to us today to say approve or disapprove this. So I think we, and I'll be glad to make a motion if it's the appropriate time to do so.
I want to make sure that we're all, you know, got our thoughts out. So any more?
Nope, I'm good.
I'm
so I have a motion on
I'm
the table.
I'm ready to move to approve this thing.
I have a motion.
And I'll second it.
Okay, so I have a motion on the floor by Ms. Steen to approve the variance, and I have a second by Mr. Caney. So with that in mind, all those in favor of the variance, please show us a sign of your hands. Okay, all those opposed, same sign. Okay, the variance passed by this commission.
Then we need to
wait. Now we need to read the motion to approve it. Since you've recommended approval of variance, we need to do the motion.
Approve the plat.
Right. Okay. So, do I have a motion on the table to approve the plat?
Move to approve.
All right. Second?
Second. Need to read the...
Yeah, you want to read that?
Move to approve that the final plat for Victoria Putt-Putt subdivision be disapproved subject to the approval of the submitted variance request by the City Council and the reoffer of any dedications upon an approval of said variance. If the variance is approved by the City Council, which we are not, the plat will be considered approved by the Planning Commission. Okay.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second. Somebody.
Second by Mr. Spears. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Okay. Motion passes. Thank you.
Did you say 5-2?
What?
Did you say 5-2?
No, it was all.
Okay.
I wanna...
Our next agenda item is a driveway variance at 904 North Craig Street and 608 West San Antonio. This is a 0.224 acres located at the corner of San Antonio North Craig. The property currently has two residences on it. One is utilized as the home and the other is currently a guest house. The owner is seeking a variance to install a driveway to the guest house located on the property at 904 North Craig. This is kind of the proposed layout. You can't see the colors very well, but there is a red section at the north of the plat, or at the north of the survey. It indicates the driveway where they're intending to place the house, or the position where they're intending to place the driveway. Here is an aerial of the site. The intended driveway is on the left of this picture. Another aerial on the right of this one, next to the property line there. The variance is to section 2082A1, which limits the number of driveways on a residential lot to one driveway per local street the residential property fronts. Approval of the variance would allow the owner to install the second driveway on North Craig Street for the guest house. There is currently the driveway on North Craig Street. The existing homes were built in 1925 before the driveway ordinance was adopted. Granting the variance would allow the guest house to have its own driveway, and it would reduce the street parking for the property. Here's a picture of the intended spot of the driveway to the left of the home there. That is the guest house in the picture. Here's a picture of the two houses side by side. The driveway would be on the left behind that silver car there. In favor of the variance, it would not create a negative effect on the property. The on-street parking would be reduced, and it would allow the guest house to have its own driveway. Against the variance, staff have consistently administered the driveway ordinance since 1999 and have denied placement of second driveways on residential properties that do not meet the requirements. Staff does recommend approval of this variance. And I believe the applicant's here if there are any questions for him.
Guest house have a separate address or no?
I believe it is address 904 North Craig, and the main residence is address 608 West San Antonio.
It's on San Antonio, yeah.
How wide is it, Torn? The driveway? Will it fit a car there?
Please state your name and address, sir.
Torn Bells, 6007 Northeast Acklands Parkway. It's about a little over 9 feet is what we're proposing for the drive. On the pictures, it didn't look like there was room, but there's a little over 9 feet there for a driveway, honestly, my daughter's going to live in the house, and we're expecting I'm expecting a grandbaby, so I'm excited about that. But my main purpose is to get her car off the street so that she can have access to get the baby out without being on the street to do it.
I'm for anything to get the cars off the street. That drives me nuts.
I know that area too, and it can. Because there's, when you drive down that street, you can't go all the.
It's a dead end.
Yeah,
it's a dead end street.
And it does get congested when there's people over there. So I, you know, it's one car, but yeah, I agree with you on that, Greg.
That's all. I was just curious how wide it was. It looks so narrow.
Yeah, the pictures are deceiving, but there is definitely my idea is to have her be able to pull in and then just be able to, she's not going to pull clear in it. We're just going to put a driveway back towards the edge of the house. And I've already talked to the neighbor and they're good with it. We've already talked to the water department. We need to move the water meter, but we're prepared to do all that at our expense.
Is there a setback requirement since it's going to abut the north property line?
Not that I'm aware of.
So, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Nope, jump in. Go.
Well, if we do this, then we're setting a precedent. And we've tried to be consistent on how we're applying the second driveway ordinance.
That's true. One of the things, you know, this is, for whatever reason, there's been two houses on this property for a really long time. The prior property owner added that big garage that you saw on there in that driveway, and I don't know if there was ever a second driveway there or not for that house, but the two houses have existed on there as separate residences just on the same lot for a really long time. So I see it as a little bit unique in that it's not someone creating a second residence all of a sudden and whatnot, but yet we have been very consistent in the past about not recommending these, but I see this one as a little unique. So just adding a second driveway for a shop or the different things that you've seen over the last, you know, year or two with people coming with variances, I feel like this one's a little different.
Well, even for emergency vehicles, to have as few cars as possible on the street if they ever had to run down it.
Yes, and it, you know, we'll get, you know, the house has been rented over the years, and those cars have always parked on the street. This will at least get one car off of the street and onto the property. That'll help with that situation. It is a dead-end street, but that's on.
So just for clarification, it's one lot as platted, two separate addresses, correct?
Correct.
So in the event that, and I'm trying to look at it objectively, we're
down
putting,
the road, you mean?
We're putting one driveway for a residence in the event he ever wanted to separate it off.
Yeah, it's you.
So we're not putting two driveways for one residence. We're putting one
driveway.
He has
right.
one driveway for this residence. We're putting a driveway for this residence.
That's right.
And it's
so even though it's the same lot, you're actually allowing a driveway for another residence that has a separate post office address, everything. So that helps me justify a little bit.
Absolutely, yeah.
Go ahead, Jared.
I was just going to say it's the way the lot is configured because of that large garage that was on there. The remainder of the lot where the little guest cottage is at is too small of a lot to separate out. It's, I don't know, 3,000 square feet or something. Right. It's really small.
You couldn't replant it as a separate
right.
lot because
right.
you'd have to have a variance for that.
Yes, sir.
Jared, is there going to be enough room to put, because I heard 9 foot, and then I'm looking at the city's recommendation that the driveway needs to be 10 foot wide. With 3 foot skirts, so we're talking about a 16 foot street frontage. Is there going to be enough room to really put all that?
That 10 foot is measured at the property line, so it can be 10 foot there, and then the parking pad, you know, could be.
So is the 3 foot flare just on one side or both sides?
It's on both sides. That's down at the right of way where you've got more room. So those, you know, flares will just go out more into the yard.
Okay. So it's not going to encroach on the neighbor's property?
Well, no, that one will, but it sounds like he's talked to the neighbor, and if they're okay with it, we allow it.
Jaron said it. I asked Jaron this question. It doesn't matter if it's in the right of way, correct? Because the 3 foot apron on the north side will be across the property line.
Yeah.
Right, but it's still on city property.
Yeah, it's still city property.
Okay. And have you got anything from the neighbor saying? I've been in this situation before where today's neighbor said, oh, yeah, sure, no problem. And then 5 years down the road, the neighbor then said, how come your driveway is a foot over onto my property? I want it gone. Are you getting something legal from your neighbor saying that it's okay for them to do it?
No, I mean, we haven't talked about the flares yet. I'm just proposing the driveway, but I talked to the neighbor today, and he's fine with whatever. He even said I could move his fence, which I wouldn't do, but he's okay. He understands the reason I'm doing it. But the, what I'm proposing is just a driveway. I mean, to me, and again, I know this is an unusual situation because there's two houses on one lot. But if we allow a house to be put on a property, to me, you should allow a driveway for that house. I mean, it just makes sense.
If we're going to do it, which I think we should, but I think we need to do it the right way, and I just want to make sure that there's no problems with the neighbor.
The flares, I haven't talked to him about the flares. I mean, my thought would be to put a flare on one side, on our side. I don't know that I would, unless we have to. I was planning to put a flare on his side.
Yeah, could you leave a flare off? Because the only way you'll ever get into the driveway is one way, and you'll drive into the driveway like this.
Right.
You'll never come in from the other side ever.
Well, you'll back out. You'll back out because you're backing out of the driveway.
That's true.
You'll need that other radius. So, it's up to this. You know, he doesn't necessarily have to have the other property owner's permission because it's in the city right away.
Right.
And in this case, the current owner definitely got a legal notice that about the driveway variance, so they've had an opportunity to comment. Their existing driveway is on the other side of their lot, and if they sell it in 5 years, this is an existing condition that it'll be quite obvious that it's in front of them.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I just want to make sure that Mr. Bales's interests are protected down the road, and thank you. Sounds like they will be.
Any more questions for Mr. Bell? All right.
Thank you.
All right. Go ahead and if that's all for the planning staff briefing, let's go ahead and open it up for a public hearing on this variance. Anybody wishing to speak on this subject, please do so at this time. All right. No one. I'll go ahead and close the public hearing, and I'll open up for our deliberations. We talked about it enough. Do I hear a motion?
I move that we approve the variance.
Okay, I got a motion on the table.
I second.
And a motion on the table to approve the variance by Mr. Caldwell, a second by Mr. Canning. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Variance passed. All right.
Our next agenda item is the Francis Marie subdivision, located on Houston Highway. This is a setback variance request. It's located at 2505 Houston Highway, and it's across from the Citizens Medical Center. The property contains an existing commercial development. It's the former site of the Siesta and Mi Vaca restaurants. It was recently platted as Lot 1, Block 1 of the Francis Marie subdivision, and during that time, a 10-foot right-of-way dedication was acquired. This caused the existing building to encroach into the 25-foot building setback line. Here you can see the plat, or a survey, and you can see the building line already encroaching into the existing building. What they are proposing is to make a veranda, a portico, and two fountains and place them on the front of the facade. This would further encroach into the right-of-way. You can see the two fountains here at the top of the screen, the two circles there, as well as part of the veranda and portico. Here's an elevation. The north side is the front there. You can kind of see the porch they'd be adding on. Here are some aerial images of the site. A closer view. This is a ground level view of the area that would be the variance would be for. They're intending to extend a few feet out with the porch and veranda.
When you say a few feet, what are you talking?
Four feet.
4 feet from the front of the existing building out?
Sir.
Not much of a veranda.
The variance request is the City Code Section 2164, which requires the new structures not encroach into the minimum required building setbacks. They're wishing to remodel the property and include the improvements, portico, veranda, and two fountains. Approval of the variance would allow these improvements to encroach into the setbacks. During platting, the 10-foot right-of-way dedication was acquired, and that pushed the existing building into the 25-foot setback. They wish to further encroach with the construction. No vehicular access will be available between the improvements and the right-of-way. In favor of the variance, it would not create a negative effect on the surrounding property. It will allow the owner to remodel and beautify their property. The traffic and site distance to Houston Highway will not be impacted. And the initial encroachment occurred due to the city acquiring the 10-foot right-of-way dedication. Against, it would create a non-conforming lot. And the applicant is here if you have any questions, or I can answer any questions you may have.
When it was replatted, why did we acquire the additional 10 feet?
Why did we require it?
Yeah.
When platting, we typically do.
The city's master thoroughfare plan, just like your last variance, requires right-of-way, and we get that whenever when properties are platted or replatted. This section of Houston Highway is designated as a primary arterial, which requires an ultimate right-of-way width for design standards to 120 feet. There's a current width of 100 feet of right-of-way that's already in place, and so the way the subdivision ordinance works is you give half of what they ultimately required. So it's 100 existing, we need 120 ultimately, so they dedicated the 10 feet, which has been done on several of those properties. McDonald's was redeveloped several years ago. We got 10-foot right-of-way dedication and so on. So
he could ask for a different variance then. Instead of setbacks, could he have asked?
Staff prefers this method,
really?
Because we got the right-of-way. Okay. So this was our preference. to have gotten the right-of-way dedication so that we've got that secured. And then because the initial improvements, most of that would not have encroached the old building line had the dedication not gone in place, we chose to support this. The site's being completely redeveloped. We're getting green space in that area. You know, it's, I feel like it's a good compromise, and it was a better of the two solutions from a staff standpoint to get, go ahead and secure that right-of-way, but then turn around and support a variance that would have let them encroach that building line.
So let's look at that picture, please.
Which one, sir?
That one. So what you're saying is we won't have, what I heard, there's not going to be any traffic from here. So all these arrows?
From side of the building to side of the building. The area directly in front of the building would not have traffic.
Okay.
So no parking or anything there anymore.
Okay.
That'd be good.
Yeah, that's what I'm just thinking. That's pretty good.
Got a question. A zillion years ago, was this when it was built, was this originally the jet drive-in?
Yes, sir.
Was?
Yes, sir.
I remember that.
That's historical.
You don't believe that, but I do remember that.
You barely remember.
Barely remember, right? So
this is going to remove all parking from in front of the building then by doing this?
You see that you won't have that parking in front anymore.
That's going to be veranda, and then the fountains will be in front of the veranda, and that'll be green space there in front of the building.
Yes, sir.
I like the idea. It just gets my funny bone a little bit that we took 10 feet and now we're given 4 feet back. And if we give a variance, like Mr. Wayne said, the only way we're going to get that 4 feet back is to condemn the property and take it.
This is different. We're getting the right-of-way, and the right-of-way is ours. What we're giving up is that required setback. Okay. We're giving him more buildable area in front. And there's a staff condition on here that, you know, if redevelopment of the site occurs, you know, decades later or whatever, someone bulldozes the building, then the new building will need to comply to the platted building lines.
So they accepted it for this, but not for the putt-putt course. It's the same thing, in essence.
Yeah. Similar. Slightly.
The end result is the same.
Yeah, it could have been done a different way. This could have been done a different way.
Same with the license.
And the license agreement, too.
The license agreement, same way.
Are the fountains going to be more or less in the area of the back arrow?
They're going to be kind of directly in front of the entrance. You can see the circles on the plan there at the top. That's where they're going to be located. Which
is
appears,
that a yes or no?
It appears to be further away from the sign.
I'm sorry?
It appears to be away from the sign. So no.
And the entrance faces Rio Grande?
Yes, sir.
So the fountains will be facing Rio Grande?
Yes, sir.
Is there some concern about traffic and water spray?
Probably a question for Jared.
There's still
5 feet, 6 feet from back of curb. No.
I don't know,
like
if we
5 feet off the back of curb.
Looks like they're 5 feet off the back of curb.
I'm sorry.
Looks like they're 5 feet away from the curb. The fountains.
5 feet away from the street.
Yes, sir. Looks if we're reading the dimensions on the plan right.
Do we have the engineer here? Please come.
John McNeil, 101 Pasadena.
Thank you, Doc.
Hi again. No, really, if you look there, It's that 10-foot, what's the term for that? The city gets it, that's okay. The 10-foot right-of-way, that's what I'm talking about. A 10-foot right-of-way, and then there's a 25-foot setback, and you can tell that that put the front of the building in the setback zone. So really what we wanted was to put a covered porch on the front that, you know, we're going to have to put sidewalks for handicap. We're going to have all that, and we're going to have sidewalks in the front. So we just wanted the sidewalks covered. And had we not had the 10-foot thing, we would have been fine. But when this came up with the replatting, because once again we had to replat this thing because it was platted, I think, as two separate lots or something. The fountains, uniquely enough, will be small fountains. And to answer the question about the water, no, there's no, I don't think any wind would blow the amount of water that we're going to put through those fountains. They're not big fountains. They're only about 3 foot. They're more decorative than anything else. So there won't be any problem with water going through there. Actually, that little small portico out there will come out a couple of more feet past the sidewalk. It's more decoration than anything else. There's no occupied structure there. All this is going to be is a sidewalk with the only thing that will actually be on the ground will be some posts that will hold the ceiling up there. So there's really, it's certainly not occupied. It's only going to come out 4 or 5 feet. And the answer to that other question, we'll still be 25 foot back from the, even if we went out 10 foot, we'd still be 25 foot away from the traffic flow. Now, in the front, what we're going to do is put at the curves of the building. Can you go to that other picture that has the front of the building with Mivaca on it? I'm sorry. Yeah, that one right there. If you look right there, kind of where the sign is and going all the way across the front of the building, we're going to build curbs all the way across 259, and that whole front area will be grass. And so I think it's going to be very nice. The front of the building also, too, will have a we're going to go up above the top on the roof and have the portico or have the covered area come off of that. It ought to be very pretty when we get through with it. I think it'll look better, and there will be no traffic. That's kind of a weird deal, the way they made that drive-through go through there, because you kind of come across traffic, and then you're driving down the side of the road against traffic.
I see that
looks kind of, and that makes me a little nervous. Well, I guess at least you're close to the hospital. But
that's a true statement.
You could probably limp across the street. But
you don't get hit.
But anyway, so that. And I'm sure that in the front up there, I'm sure that we'll need to put a sidewalk, and that'll be fine. And if you look down further where they built Jaguar, whatever it is, there's a bunch of Jaguar stuff over there, but they have a sidewalk too, so we would connect that. So there would be a nice sidewalk going all across that. It'll be pretty grass, and we're going to sprinkler it so it'll stay green.
Nice.
So, I mean, it'll be pretty, and really the only thing we're asking for, we're not asking to build a structure in there. We just want to put that covered area so that in the rain and weather and stuff, that people that are walking up that sidewalk. We have to put something there anyway just for ADA, because we're going to have a ramp going up, because it's about that much higher than the parking lot. Mm-hmm. So, and we're going to redo the parking lot as well. So it ought to be very pretty when we get through it. You know, we have land in the back that goes all the way back in the back. If you look on that one plat, we're going to extend the parking lot out the back too. I don't think I need a variance for that. So I'm all variance out.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Any other questions on that? I mean, and that was the thing. I mean, it was like, well, we're going to take 10 foot there, but I need a few foot up here. So they said, well, you got to have a variance. I said, oh, okay.
Mr. Wayne?
Question, is the sign affected in any way? Is the sign in compliance with rebuilding a structure? Wouldn't that put the sign too close to the street by code?
If you're asking if you took the sign down and needed to build it new, yeah, the sign would have to be put set back, but as it is now, it's in a grandfathered location, and it's going to be able to, you know, they'll be able to change out the sign face and be fine.
I understand there's a grandfather situation, or could be a grandfather situation, but that's on the sign. Provided there's nothing being done with the building, if we're doing something to the building, doesn't the grandfather go away?
No, sir. No, it doesn't. Unless you wipe the site clean, that sign and that's not what they're doing, the sign is able to remain. Even if you trigger a site plan and trigger landscaping and all those sort of things, unless you mess with that sign, and I honestly don't know exactly how far away that sign pole is from the property line or the right-of-way. We did, just to correct a statement I made a while ago about the fountains being 5 foot from the curb, they're 5 foot from the property line, so they're probably more like 7, 8, 10 feet away from the actual curb, so the fountains are a little further back than I stated a while ago.
I know what you're saying. It's almost like it's two separate entities, the sign and the building.
Yeah, there are different rules. There are different rules for the sign, and you, that don't apply to when you redevelop the site. So
as long as they don't take the sign down and then try to re-erect it, they're okay.
They're okay. Yes, sir.
We might take it down.
Then you're going to have to move it further.
Absolutely, and that's fine. I don't mind moving it back. Yeah. I actually went through that when we did our Twin Fountains over on Sam Houston, because they did a 5 foot easement on the thing, and then my sign was like about a foot in the bad area, and so we had to have a variance to do that. Now that sign would have been hard to move. This one here, I'm not real attached to it. So if we do it, I think you have to be 11 foot back from the property line, is what the rule was then. Is that right?
10.
Okay. All right, but if we do that, there certainly won't be a problem moving it back. I mean, it wouldn't change anything because all it is grass up there anyway. So, unless of course it moves it back into the building because of the setback, but I guess I'd have to have a variance for that. All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all very much.
All right. That's it. All right. Let's go ahead and close it. We'll open up for a public hearing. Anybody wish to address this commission on the subject, please do so at this time. Okay, we don't have anybody. We'll go ahead and close it. Our deliberations. Again, I hammered this one out too. Do I hear a motion to approve this variance?
I move.
I have a motion on the table to approve this variance by Ms. Steen.
Second.
Second by Mr. Caldwell. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Variance passed.
And I'd like to say to both of these men, Mr. Rails and Dr. McNeil, they have done more to help improve the look of Victoria and surrounding Victoria than anybody. And we're very lucky to have you all and what you're doing to make our town prettier.
I agree with you, and I appreciate you saying that. Thank y'all, too. Anybody? All right, next.
Our next agenda item is the GTOTA subdivision, number 4, re-subdivision number 1. This is a final plat, 1.308 acres, located near the intersection of East Airline Road and North Ben Wilson Street. They're wishing to plat the property into two planned shopping center lots under a C2 designation. The property is owned by George A. TOTA. The property contains an existing commercial development. There's an existing variance for lot 1RA along East Airline Road that allows the development to utilize an existing 17.8-foot front setback line rather than the 25 typically required. The planned shopping center designation will allow the developer to place the westernmost interior setback line at 3 feet, where the existing building on 1RA would encroach into the setback line, and I'll have a picture to demonstrate that in a minute. And the setback lines will be placed at 20 feet around the building as shown in the plan. It may be difficult to see, but the building is on the left side of this plat. You can kind of see the markings there and the wording demonstrating it. The setbacks will follow this building 20 foot around where the building is not present, and then they jump into 3 foot where the building is. Here's an aerial view of the property. Another aerial view from further out. Water service is currently provided by an existing 6-inch main in Locust Avenue and a 12-inch main in East Airline. Sanitary sewer is provided by an existing 9-inch main in Locust and 10-inch main in North Ben Wilson. And drainage will be in accordance with the city master drainage plan of the city. And staff is has reviewed this final plat and finds that it meets the minimum requirements for a planned shopping center. And the applicant is here if there are any questions, and I may answer as well.
Any indications where the new, or will there be any new driveways put in place? Or are they?
No, sir.
Anybody have any questions on this one? Really much. So it meets all requirements, right? That's what, so. All right. Do I hear a motion on the table to approve this final plat?
So moved.
I have a motion on the table to approve this plat by Mr. Woods. Second. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Spears. All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed, same sign. Final plat passes. Thank you. Next on the agenda is other business.
The monthly development report. We had 6 minor plats come in through the city. We had the 2 majors, GTOTA and Victoria Putt-Putt, 2 variances, and we had 5 site plans come through. For the variance request for the last planning commission, Millennium Industrial Park passed City Council on Tuesday, and so did Pavliska. Aloe Landing decided not to pursue. Any further? I believe that's all I have.
Next on the agenda, item from the Planning Commission. Anybody?
Mr. Chairman, if I may, we have a...
I'm sorry.
That's all right. A couple of items. First of all, I'd like to introduce y'all to Julie Fulgham. She's our new assistant director for the department. Started a couple weeks ago, I guess. So it'll be... seeing her around and hearing
Julie.
Julie, glad to have you on our team.
Happy to be here.
Also on your desk, I believe, was a preliminary timeline for the city's new Plan 2035. It's our comprehensive plan effort that we're starting to get underway. Highlighted in December, we now have a date. There are 3 joint workshops that the commission will have with City Council as we work through the vision, existing conditions, and what the future of Victoria will look like. The first of those is scheduled for December 4th. Be in the Bronte Room, which is the big meeting room at the library, on December 4th at 5:30. So we'll have you all, rather than have it here with one group up there and one group out here, we'll all be around the table in the Bronte Room and be able to have a good discussion about where we see Victoria going in the future. So that kickoff meeting again is December 4th, and we'll be emailing you to remind you of all of that, because I guess we'll probably have one more planning commission meeting between now and then, but just wanted to get that out there on your calendars as soon as possible. So I guess that's probably all I have to say about the comprehensive plan. Now, if we have a meeting next month, then we'll have some more detail to start telling you about the planning process itself, but that's it for now.
Just out of curiosity, who did you contract with?
Keating Keese Collaborative. They're out of Sugar Land. It's a larger firm, but they're out of Sugar Land.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I see it on the bottom. My fault.
Yeah. So they're a good firm. They've done quite a bit of work. A couple of the planners and staff, when they worked with other firms, have done some work in Victoria in the past. And then this specific firm's done work in Cuero, Port Lavaca, Amarillo, all around the state. They're doing a similar process for Lake Jackson. So they've got a lot of experience in working kind of with mid-sized cities and obviously some smaller cities around this. So I think they're a good fit for us.
Question for you. What time of day is this going to be?
This particular meeting will be at 5:30 in the evening. And
2 or 3 hour meeting.
I think he was talking about an
max 2 hours.
Yeah, max 2 hours. I think we'll probably be out a little sooner, but we'll get a little more detail of that and get that more information out to you. But if you can reserve that on the calendar now, that would be most appreciated. I guess that's a Thursday, isn't it?
Yeah. December 4th.
4th? Is that
December 4th. So that's all
that's
I have.
It?
Sorry.
All right. Let's go ahead and do items from the Planning Commission. Anybody have any questions? Did you have? Did you get your question answered about the property? I didn't know.
No, I didn't.
All right. Okay, very good. You have anything new coming that you can tell us or anything? Any new businesses possibly?
I believe all we have are what you saw on here.
Okay.
On the site plan. There's, you know, the fuel station, Toyota's expanding the parking lot.
Okay.
That Country Lane townhomes that we've kind of been, you know, dealt with different pieces of that over the last year and a half. I think we're really, if I understood today, we're really close to issuing them a permit for the first 84, I think it was 84 units. So we'll get underway with that.
Those going to be for rent or for sale?
Those are for rent. It's,
okay.
They're calling them townhomes. It's a multifamily development. Best way I can describe it.
Just Tesla charging stations.
Do what?
No Tesla charging stations?
No, nothing quite like that yet.
We're in all country down here, man.
There's a number of things kind of hovering around, and we're, I sure hope within the next, you know, couple of weeks and months we get some announcements from some of the folks that are kind of floating around out there.
I just want to pass on to you that your staff out in the field does an outstanding job of communicating with the public. Had an occasion to have one visit one of my properties because a neighbor didn't think that a mud puddle should have been a mud puddle, and your staff came and they were great, and if they handled everybody else as well as they communicated with me, we've got a great staff out in the field.
Thank you. I'll be sure to pass that along,
and it will be taken care of.
Good.
All right. If that's it, do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All right. Motion by Ms. Steen and second by Mr. Woods. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Uh-huh.